May the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Karl Barth, the European theologian, used to say that to preach, one should stand in the pulpit with the newspaper in one hand and the Word of God in the other. Well, what's in the newspaper this week? The stock markets hit new highs. Basketball finds resurrection. At least I think that's what they think at the university. Jonestown murders of innocent children. Larry Koss, who was the highest paid executive in the United States, gave back a few of the $106 million he made as an income. And this quote in an editorial page: "The United States has the most unequal distribution of income among advanced countries, and the degree of inequality has been growing steadily over the past several decades," summarizes Harvard economist Richard Freeman. "The share of income going to the top fifth rose by 13% between 1979 and 1996, while the share going to the bottom fifth fell by 22%. How do we have a dialogue between that newspaper and this often quoted and I think much abused statement by Jesus, "Let her do what she wants, because the poor you will always have with you"? Well, that was the gospel text for this week's lectionary in virtually all of the Lutheran churches that we might have attended. What a way to end Minnesota Food Share Month. And what a way to begin this week in which we're trying to focus on the growing income gaps, not just in the world, but in the United States. Time magazine, hardly the bearer of revolutionary tidings, had an article last year identifying that between 1974 and 1994, the average executive salary in comparison to his or her own employees went from a ratio of 24 to 1 to 224 to 1. How do we hold this gospel text in the context of these kinds of realities? Well, this last week when I was trying to figure out what to do with this Gospel of John, I went to the library and had a wonderful dialogue with an old New Testament professor of mine from Union Seminary. He helped me, with my sociological hat on, to go back and think about this gospel written in its context with a struggling community toward the end of the first century, under fire of its struggled within the synagogue, under fire in an ever-changing first century world. And Lewis Martin and others pointed out that this was a gospel written by a community to express its faith, its deep and abiding faith, not a history, not a factual account, but a statement of what it meant to live in their time. So the temptation is to take this quote out of context and to forget in the very next chapter, Jesus goes on to offer what I think is the statement of his life and his ministry and our call, where he basically says to the disciples, "You know, when Mary washed my feet," in another gospels it was an unnamed woman, "did you get it?" And he said, "I'm going to wash your feet." And they said, "Oh, no, no, no." He said, "You just don't get it." This ministry is about service and compassion. This ministry is about writing a gospel in your time and in your place. It's a ministry about relationship, not about legalism. Marcus Borg, who many of us are reading in a discussion group here on campus, reminds us that Jesus, among many other things that he did, played a fundamental role in converting this from a religion of purity and law to a community of compassion and caring and love. So I think the question for you and me as we this week think about the Bataldon Lecture Series, as we end Minnesota Food Share Month, is how then shall we live? How then shall we live? The first century church started writing its own gospel. What kind of gospel will you and I write? The other texts for this Sunday give us another clue. Isaiah wrote, "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" We who come from the Christian tradition are convinced that in Christ God makes all things new. How will you and I be a part of this ongoing recreation that we are called to write and to be? How then shall we live? How will we write our gospel? What kind of statement of faith can you and I make? The newspaper of the last week dramatically showed us a teacher who stepped in front of a gunshot and gave her life for her children. It's pretty powerful stuff. On a slightly more down-to-earth level, the CEO of the PepsiCo company, who grew up on the Iron Range, basically has given away his entire salary. Well, it'll be used for our college scholarships and scholarships for the blue-collar workers and the lowest paid people who work for their company. That's a kind of important statement. Starting in yesterday's paper and running today, there's a fascinating series of community banks that we've often pointed our finger to and the destruction they've wrought in neighborhoods. But community banks in the Twin Cities, under the leadership of folks there who are helping to rebuild their communities. How do we have a balance between Jesus' absolutely passionate concern for individuals and the rebuilding of systems and the humanizing of the world in which we live? I think we can get some clues from these people. A group of us in an honor seminar read a book called Common Fire, about 100 people who have devoted their lives to the common good. And we ended that seminar with the students in the class interviewing Augsburg alums and people who work here. People like the Bataldons, the Torstensons, the Muggies. People whose lives are spelled out in rewriting the gospel for this time and in this place. We've heard from this pulpit Nancy Pearson, Patty Lee, John Evans, Bruce Shoemaker. These are not people off in some lofty cloud. These are people who came through this place and globally and locally write and rewrite the gospel in their own lives. The Center for Global Education urges, invites, and makes it possible for us to go to listen, not to fix the poor, but to listen at their feet and hear their voices and be strengthened by them. We have students interning in the community for community development agencies, learning, being, the service learning program, opportunities for us to learn from, to take our stance as people who are educated for leadership and service to the world. How then shall we live? Well, let me conclude with the title of a book that haunts and inspires me. Paulo Freire, Miles Horton, two giants of this century, got together just before each of them died and had a conversation, and the book was entitled, "We Make the Road by Walking." The exciting thing about being in this community is there's an awful lot of wonderful people to walk with. Generations come and go, but you and I make the road by walking. It's an exciting trip. And I conclude with the prayer of Reinhold Niebuhr, because it is perhaps a context for our journey. God, give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, but grant us the courage to change the things that should be changed, and the wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Amen.
You can be seated. I'd like to call your attention to this week's chapel schedule in the bulletin. And tomorrow, Norma Noonan from the Political Science Department will be with us, so please come back. And I would like to invite Marie McNeff to come and say a few words.
I'm most pleased to say that we will have cake in the community time because of our speaker today, and I want to tell you why. Gary Hesser, a week ago on this day, around noon, was honored in an assemblage of 3,000 people gathered in Atlanta in a conference taking learning seriously. Gary had an honor roll call here this morning, but his name was left off of that honor roll, and I'm adding Gary Hesser to that honor roll name in terms of community, in terms of service, in terms of compassion. We now have at Augsburg College a center for service, work, and learning. And that center is the inspiration and the culmination of much good work that Gary Hesser has done. And so I thought it would be appropriate just to interrupt and stop the benediction for a moment to let us celebrate Gary Hesser. And we will do that in the community time with cake. Congratulations, Gary.
Receive the benediction. Glory to the Creator who gives us life. Glory to Christ, the servant of love. Glory to the Spirit who empowers us forward. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also.
Let us pray. Dear God, we often find it hard to understand that in the midst of suffering, you have the power to create joy. Forgive our doubts and lead us into quiet confidence through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, one God within our world today. Amen.
The reading today comes from Luke chapter 6, verses 20 through 26. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you, on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. Here ends the reading.
Good morning. With the gracious cooperation of Pastor Dave, the chapel services this week are coordinated with the Applied Ethics Seminar to be held on Thursday and Friday. The theme of that symposium is the compensation gap, seeking social justice in today's market economy, in which we shall examine the ethical and personal aspects of the growing income disparity within the society and the world. Yesterday, Gary Hesser gave us a marvelous introduction to that theme. As I thought about my chapel homily for today, I wanted to connect Lent, since we are in the next to the last week of Lent, and the theme of the Ethics Symposium, because we had purposely chosen to have the Ethics Symposium during Lent in order to make that connection. And so I began to plan my chapel homily for today, and I gave a lot of thought as to how to put all of this together in one talk of less than 10 minutes. I thought, and I thought. I checked the scripture readings for the fifth Sunday of Lent, which we observed on Sunday, but they did not seem to fit my particular thoughts. Last week, I went away for a few days to a resort, which may be the only one in the United States that does not have a Gideon Bible in every unit. So I was even, at some point, emailing Lil, asking her to check various biblical references as I thought of them. And then I came back over the weekend and checked through and checked through and checked through and finally found what I wanted. And it seemed to me that the scripture reading that we just heard, which I think was from the sixth Sunday of Ordinary Time this year, fit very, very well. I decided to focus on voluntary simplicity, a philosophy of life that I thought connects well the theme of Lent and the symposium. We live in a society of contradictions. There is growing poverty and hardship amidst great luxury and abundance. My Sunday paper, which was close to 3 inches thick, mostly advertisements about what we could and should buy, had as the cover story on the weekend issue a poor child who didn't have enough to eat. And there is the contrast for us. We are living with the daily temptations of the consumer society. It's a society in which it is very hard to choose voluntary simplicity. We are bombarded with messages that tell us, seek the good life. You deserve it. You need it. This is good for you. These messages are overwhelming. It is so overwhelming that it is hard to focus on Lent in this society. Lent is traditionally conceived of as a time of penitence, reflection, and self-sacrifice. And this runs up against the distractions of our society. Many Christians are oblivious to Lent and unaware of its significance, even though they grew up in the Christian faith and often are practicing Christians now. Recently, I asked a student at another college who is an active Christian whether he had classes on Good Friday at his college. He said, I don't know. When is Good Friday? The everyday crush of activities that we all face has turned our attention away from this season of repentance. And the many luxuries and distractions that we have make it hard for us to focus on the reflection and voluntary self-sacrifice. If you think about the last week, what have you heard about? The Final Four, the World Skating Championships, and other kinds of entertainment. I grew up in a tradition where where children normally would give up something for Lent, and I still continue that. Actually, I gave up chocolates and ice cream, two of my favorite things, for Lent. But that's not really a sacrifice. That's a very minor token sort of thing. Sacrifice in the broader sense of giving up some of the pleasures of life, the distractions of life, the amusements of life, in favor of a more simple life. The decision to adopt a more simple life is not an easy one. It is a difficult one. But some people have done it and adopted a life of voluntary simplicity. Now, what does that mean? It means buying only the minimum that you need. Living without luxury. Keeping your car for 10 years instead of trading it in, maybe even 15 years, whatever. In recent years, this lifestyle has attracted a lot of people, some of whom were six-figure executives with what I would describe as a fast-track lifestyle. Indeed, locally, we have various discussion groups that have been formed among those who seek a simpler lifestyle. I think that conscious choice to have a simple life responds to the basic message of Lent, which is a life of dedication to the way of God rather than the way of human pleasures, as it were. It is also a response to the acquisitive urge in all of us, in a society which emphasizes acquisition of everything. This is also a society that has fueled a growing gap between the haves and the have-nots. The 3-inch Sunday paper with the ads contrasted with the picture of the little child who doesn't have enough to eat. In the U.S. today, we have the largest gap in the world, in the developed world, between the income of the rich and the income of the poorest in our society. And this has worsened in the years since 1980. Pursuing a life of simplicity is one way to respond to the rat race of acquisition. This is a hard choice for all of us, not the least of which is myself. Take one simple area, books. I recently read of a woman who, as part of her life of voluntary simplicity, has limited herself to owning 30 books in any given time. Only 30. Some are permanent, ones that she never parts with. Others come and go. She has 5 to 10 books at any given time, which she looks at as temporary. She reads them, she sells them, or gives them away. I look at my own life, a life of abundant books. I try to implement, in terms of my personal reading, not my professional reading, but my personal reading, the sell one, buy one. And I regularly trade, but I'm still a long way from achieving her level of 30. My professional books, of course, if you're a professor and you're doing research and teaching, the professional books I look at is the tools of the trade. But even there, I try to give away quite a few. We all have too many things, starting with me. The issue to ask ourselves is, what do we want? And what do we need? And is there a big difference? These are questions we can all ask ourselves if we attempt to pursue a simpler life or a life of voluntary simplicity. Can we separate our needs from our wants? Most of us have more than we need. As I say, starting with me, I was much the subject of this as anyone. You may very well ask, I'm a college student. I don't have abundance. Don't you? When I was a student, I lived in a dorm with very severe restrictions on what you could bring. Not only that, we had cleaning ladies who cleaned the place regularly, and we always thought were secret agents for the CIA to check on what we had in the dorms. Even a coffee pot was forbidden. I didn't have one, but I had a friend who had a coffee pot, and she every Monday morning hid it in her underwear, hoping the cleaning ladies would not find it. See, today they very few colleges have cleaning personnel, but we're convinced that in Indiana they had them primarily as spies. I brought with me a portable record player, which I had saved up a lot of money to buy. It wasn't very expensive, but it took me a long time to save for it, and a typewriter. And that was pretty normal. Today, college students go off to college with a microwave, a refrigerator, a stereo, a TV, a VCR, a computer, and heaven only knows what else. My own son went off to college with enough furniture to furnish a small apartment. And that's partly because he had a friend who was selling all his stuff, so he bought all the stuff real cheap. But he has much more than he needs. And most of us have more than we need. The average American child today not only sees many hours of television a week, he or she also has a TV and often a VCR in the bedroom. And it's one of the factors contributing to separateness in the family and this sort of habit that I have to have the TV because I have to have it in my bedroom. And these are national studies showing that this is sort of the trend. Now, I'm not suggesting we give away our stereos or our computers. Heaven only knows, probably some of my students are here. They'll tell me that after they heard me speak, they gave away their computer. Now they can't do a darn paper. I am only suggesting that we give some thought to what we have and whether we need it all. This is a first step in creating a life of voluntary simplicity. We have had on our faculty at various times people who have lived the life of voluntary simplicity, and very few others have known that. I can think of one person who was both on the faculty and the administration for many years, who I think limited herself to having at any given time like three skirts and a couple of dresses, and no one ever realized it. She's always a very nice dresser. No one ever realized it, but her whole life was built around voluntary simplicity. Our speaker for the symposium, our keynoter, has built his life around voluntary simplicity as well. But I think that the whole aspiration toward a life of voluntary simplicity is one that fulfills the spirit of Lent and also responds to the problems that are a byproduct of our society of haves and have-nots. For me, I will honestly confess that voluntary simplicity is an ideal. It is not a reality. I try to make it a reality, but I'm far from achieving it. But it is something for all of us to think about, to reflect on, and to pray about. Please join me in prayer. Lord in heaven, help us to reflect on our lives, what we have, and what we need. Help us to embrace a life of voluntary simplicity as we try to live our lives in your way, not in the ways of the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We will sing stanza one of On Eagle's Wings. Tomorrow in chapel, we welcome Arthur Treadwell, and during community time, we will celebrate with cake the MIAC championship basketball team. So come back tomorrow for that. Receive the benediction. Because Christ lives, because the Spirit flourishes, grace, mercy, and peace are yours. Accept it with joy and serve God gladly. Go in peace and serve the Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. Grant that it may bear fruit abundantly. Give us grace to grow in faith, hope, and love, to live in Christ's name. Amen.
This morning we're pleased to welcome Becky Von Fisher from Calvary Church in South Minneapolis, an Augsburg grad. And she is going to invite us to participate in some summer activities with them.
I am a pastor of an urban congregation at 39th in Chicago, where every summer for 6 weeks we provide a place where 60 elementary age young people can come 5 days a week, all day, to learn and study reading and math, to develop skills in things like art, music, drama, athletics, dance, to learn about God's love for them and studying Bible stories, to have an opportunity to give back through community service, and maybe most importantly, also they learn to experience or have the experience of God's love through staff relationships, young adults who care for them, who mentor them, encourage them, give them guidance. We are looking for staff for the summer program. There are positions that we are hiring for. We're looking for young adults who have a real love for children, who have experience working with them, and who would like to be a part of an important youth outreach ministry and enter into partnership with us on this. There are all kinds of possibilities with this program. This year, for the first time, we are being approved as an alternate summer school site for the Minneapolis Public Schools. And I'd be happy to talk with anyone that would like to explore an opportunity for some possibility for internship as well as paid staff position. I will be here after chapel and would encourage anyone to come and talk with me, and I have information in writing. Thank you.
Thank you, Becky. That's a very exciting congregation. Even if you can't participate in the summer program, go down there and see what they're doing. It's not far from here. We'll stand and sing the first stanza of Precious Lord, 731.
Oh. Scriptures from Acts 6, 1 through 7. Now during those days, when the disciples were increasing in number, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. And the 12 called together the whole community of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should neglect the word of God in order to wait on tables. Therefore, friends, select from among yourselves 7 men in good standing, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may appoint to this task. We will, for our part, well devote ourselves to prayer and to serving the word." What they said pleased the whole community, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, together with Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch, and they had these men stand before the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. The word of God continued to spread. The number of disciples increased greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. Here ends the reading.
You may be seated. We want you to know that every one of you needs to have those names memorized by the time we leave today. We welcome Reverend Arthur Treadwell, very exciting pastor and leader in our community today. He's from the Exodus Community Development Corporation. It's an African-American controlled company, and they are involved in rather significant work in our community, doing things such as financial development and human development, working with children who are mentally disturbed, welfare reform. They work with people to move them from dependency to self-sufficiency. They provide supportive housing, providing housing for people that are homeless, people that are HIV positive, chemically dependent. It's just incredible stuff that they are doing there. Many of you that were at the funeral service for Anita Hawthorne heard him speak, and we will never forget what he said in those days. That day, it was incredible. He's a native of Virginia, but has been here for 20 years, Reverend Arthur Treadwell.
I certainly am grateful to God to be here today and to be able to share with you this day from the Word of God. I think that to ask a African-American preacher to speak for 8 minutes is kind of a oxymoron, as it were. However, I'm willing to try to adjust to this task. I would like those people who are in the very last row to be the timekeepers. And when we get to the 8 minute point, please just lift your hand, or you could just jump up and shout hallelujah, whichever you feel would be more appropriate. I am absolutely delighted to be here and to share with you the Word of God today. This text that has been read in your hearing, I think is a very critical text as it relates to the topic of the compensation gap. That is the gap between the haves and the have-nots. And so I'd like you to ask the person next to you a question. Just kind of hunch them and say, are you a rapper or a gapper? I think we know what rappers are. They're not just people who set words to rhythmic patterns of speech, but rappers are people who spend their whole lives intellectualizing and discussing issues. They hold major conferences and gatherings, and they massage the issues and the problems all of the time that they're there. They spend many hours talking about, this is really the true nature of the problem. And after much discussion, they get up and they walk away, and the problem is seldom resolved. Such as it is with this issue of the disparity between the haves and the have-nots. But then there are gappers. You're probably wondering what a gapper is. It is not someone who buys their clothes at the Gap. That is not the purpose of our definition here. For our purposes here, we're talking about people who seriously examine this issue of disparity, who use their life's energies to try and resolve this bridge between the haves and the have-nots. Those are gappers. And it's so beautiful because here in the text, we find the first real institutional issue of racism to be found in the church. What has occurred is that there are two sets of Jews, the Hellenistic Jews, the Jews who are Greek-speaking, and the Hebrew-speaking Jews, whose original language was Aramaic. And so there is a discrepancy between these two bodies of Jews. And it manifests itself in the physical distribution of food and resources. Those widows of the Greek-speaking Jews receive less in the daily distribution than those of the Hebrew-speaking heritage. Critical issue. This is the Church of Jesus Christ. We're all equal in the church. But look, we've got a major discrepancy going on. So, the apostles, not to be outdone, call everyone together. I think this is important. They call everyone together and they say, look, it is not that we do not care about this matter, but we can't stop preaching the word of God in order to take care of this economic disparity. But let us find some men. You find some men whom you think we can handle this. And you elect them, and we will appoint them. We will lay our hands on them and anoint them for this task. Very critical point here. Because it talks about the beginning of the solution to institutional racism and institutional kinds of problems such as we have economically in this society. The first point is inclusion. They brought everybody to the table. Those that were concerned, those that were not, everybody in the community was brought together to discuss the issue. Second point is they articulated their policy. The scripture doesn't say so, but clearly they felt that there could not be this kind of inadequacy in the church of God. And so they sought to resolve the issue. Policy stated, everyone's at the table. They elect seven men, the names of which were so difficult to pronounce. I felt so sorry for her when I picked that scripture several days ago. These seven men come together, and they are, by name, Greek-speaking men. The problem was a problem among the Greek widows, the people who are elected to now take over the total task of distribution are Greek men, which says that if there is a discrepancy, we have to include those who have been discriminated against as a part of the solution. The other point here is that there is structural change. They create a whole new office. Prior to this, the apostles were the only ones, they were in charge of everything. There are some pastors like that. I'm sure not in your denominations, but in our denominations, we have pastors like that. They're just in charge of everything. But here, they do a structural change, and they set up another layer of administration. And for the problems of our society to happen, there has to be structural change. For them to be solved, there has to be structural change. And so now we have the deacons. And the deacons take on this task of administering the resources of benevolence for the community. In doing so, we never hear of this problem again. In all of the rest of the scriptures, this issue never arises again. And it leads us to believe that they solved the problem. One other piece here, I think very, very important. When they ask for the qualifications of what these men should be,
who these men should be. They said, these men should be men who have character and integrity. And then the scripture says so beautifully, as only the Word of God can do, and it says, full of the Holy Spirit. What an important distinction to be made among us, that we are people to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because when you are filled with the Spirit, it guides and leads you into all truth. And it will not even allow you to preserve your own preferences. It draws you into the perfect will of God. So I think as you discuss this issue of the have and the have-nots during this week, I think it's important to remember that the problem can be solved. The scriptures give us a formula for solving that. It is that we bring everyone together, that we state our policy, and we are determined that everyone shall share and share equally. Because actually there is more abundance in the world, you know, than there is need. God created it that way. And therefore, having stated our policy and brought everyone together, there may need to be some structural change. But ultimately, it can be solved if we are led by the Spirit of God. Let us pray. Lord, we can do nothing without you. We desire to be the men and women of God that you would have us to be. That we might walk in the beauty of the multiculturalism, of the diversity, of the greatness in which you created us. That your Spirit might abide in us and with us and through us to your glory. Anoint now those of us who are here and give us the power to move from rappers to gappers. Those people focused on bringing about the change needed in our society. And as we seek to bridge this gap, fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Reverend Treadwell. Tomorrow we have another incredible speaker, one of the most renowned lawyers in the state of Minnesota, Tom Fable, who out of conscience left private practice just a couple of months ago to be deputy mayor of St. Paul. And he has been involved in many of the important cases in the state of Minnesota the last 20 years. You should be here to hear him at 11:20. And he is, again, going to address the subject which Reverend Treadwell was on today, compensation gap. So be back here tomorrow for Tom Fable. We are now going to sing the first stanza of 734, softly and tenderly.
Thank you.
want to remind you that we have a communion service at 9:30 here tonight, and we are also responsible for another community service tonight at Grace Church. And Melissa Moyle, what time is the soup served? 6 o'clock and 7, and that's at Grace Church on the university campus, right by the hospitals. Be back here at 9:30. And what we're going to do now is give you the benediction and then move right into community time as we present the championship basketball team. You are the body of Christ and members of one another. Serve and honor one another that you may be strengthened to be Christ's body in this world. Amen. One other announcement, very important. We are going to help our brothers and sisters from Gustavus Adolphus College. Actually, brothers and sisters and daughter. My daughter is here from Gustavus and her roommate Sheila, who was in a house when the tornado hit on Sunday. It was a very frightening experience. We are going to leave here on Saturday at 7:30 in the morning and be back between 6 and 7. And if you can be of any help, we responded in a great way last year to the floods, and we hope we can respond the same way. Be in touch with me, Larry Pullman, or Mary Laurel True, and we will give you all of the details. Now I'd like to present our athletic director, Paul Grauer.
This is one of the really fun things to be involved with our athletic program, is the recognition of some outstanding achievements that we have accomplished this year. And I have with me today the trophy that is sent out by our conference office. It will have the inscription of all of our players and the coaches' names on a plaque, which is being prepared now. But I did bring this today so we could symbolically present this as the conference championship team. Today we are very happy to have this opportunity to recognize our men's basketball team for the MIAC championship season. The team completed the regular season with an outstanding 22-win and 2-loss record. Championship teams begin with a coach. Our coach, Brian Ammon, has done an outstanding job of assembling a very talented group of individuals and has skillfully orchestrated their talents into a championship team. And if you had a chance to see us play this year, a team that plays a very exciting brand of basketball. So congratulations to our team and to our coach Brian Ammon for this outstanding season. And now it is my pleasure to present to you our men's basketball coach, Brian Ammon, this year's MIAC Coach of the Year.
First of all, I just want to thank the school. In this day and age where there's a ton of budget cuts and things, I just want to thank the school for giving us the opportunity to continue to participate in athletics and to give our athletes an opportunity to excel at something that they're very good at. There's a lot of people that go into putting a team on the floor and making all this stuff happen. First of all, I want to thank Paul Grauer. He has to give up a lot of his evenings in order to put these athletic events on. In the wintertime with wrestling and with hockey and basketball, I'm not sure if he spends a night at home, and it's something that he gets to give up a lot of his time in order to do that. Also, our sports information director, I don't believe he's here right now, Don Stoner, Mike Schwartz, our equipment manager. Those are people who have to give up a lot of their time in order to make this a successful program. This year's particular season was a dream season for us. It's something that our team has been working on not only this year, but we started talking about this with this particular group of kids about 3 or 4 years ago. We sat down, we started putting goals together and working towards putting a championship team on the floor, and it finally fell into place for us this year. So it was a dream season. The record of being 22-2 is the school's single best record in the school history. So it was something that we're very proud of. And also not, you know, to win the conference championship was one of our goals. The second goal was to make it to the Division III national tournament. We were able to accomplish that. We came up a little short on our third goal, which was to try to win the region and make it to the Final Four. But it was a very successful season, and it's something that we are extremely proud of. At this time, I'd like to just recognize the team and all the people who helped put this together. I have four assistant coaches that I'd like to recognize. They're not here right now, but David Steniger, Tim Weidenbach, Mark Rudolph, and our sports psychologist who works with us, David Carlson. Without those individuals, this would not have been possible. They put in a tremendous amount of time. Again, they're out every Tuesday and Friday evening watching high school games, recruiting. Every one of these kids were talked to by our coaching staff, and that's why they are here, is because they were actively pursued by these assistant coaches. Paul says that I did this. It wasn't myself. It was a group effort with all these people. At this time, when I recognize the players, we have the majority of them are here. When I recognize you, if you could come up and stand up front here. First of all, we have Jason Beckendorf, Kyle Krubel, Devin George, Robert Grace, Mark Harris, Eric Harriod, Rob Just, Drazen Kasajic, Ryan Kovich, Chris Long, Andrew Mikulski, Travis Quast, Joffrey Reed, Chris Skelly, Adam Story, Josh Seldahl, Kevin Van Rossum, Michael Watkins, Justin Wismer, and our athletic trainer is Mike Deming. We have three captains, Neil Swanson, Willie Fisher, and Matt Lang. I don't believe it. Hats are off to you guys. You guys did a great job this year. I know the coaching staff and the school is extremely proud of you, and you accomplished something that you'll remember for a lifetime. But one other thing that I'd just like to mention in a personal note, that Devin George also was named to the second team National Association of Basketball Coaches All-American team. He is now the fourth player in the school's history to receive All-American honors. This time, Paul is going to present the actual trophy to our captains. This will be on display in our trophy case, and something you guys, when you start to come back in years, you'll be able to come back and see your name on the trophy. So, congratulations, guys! It was a great season.
What a fantastic group of young men and coaches, and just a fantastic year. Now, we'd like all of you to join us out in the atrium. We've got two cakes that are decorated appropriately with a championship designation on the top and a couple basketball players, and let's go out there and celebrate and congratulate this wonderful team. Thank you.